Namaste, and a very, very warm welcome to all of you to this lecture demonstration session. I'm very thankful to the organizers for inviting us here today. And we're going to begin today with the acclaimed singer, vocalist, musicologist, Pandit Satyashil Deshpande, who will draw upon his years of experience with performing, teaching, and researching within the khayal genre of Hindustani music. And he's going to tell us a little bit about what makes this genre unique, and about how it allows tremendous scope for individual expression of the various musicians who have contributed to this genre. And I will then request him to talk a little bit about the various voices that have found their own expression, their own space in this tradition. And after that, I will take over, and I'll talk a little bit about how we can use science and technology to really look at these voices in terms of their acoustic characteristics with a microscope, to really understand them and really apply science and technology to musicological research as well as to teaching. So hopefully this will be an enjoyable session for all of you. And main Pandit ji se ab darkhwast karunga ki wo aaye aur khayal sangeet jo hai uski jo khasiyatein hain, uski jo visheshta hai, uske bare mein hame thoda bataye, aur isme jo alag alag aawazein aawazon ne sthan paya hai uske bare mein bhi hame thoda bataye. Pandit ji,
namaskar. India International Science Festival ke sabhi aayojakon ka main aabhar manta hu ki mujhe isme shirkat karne ki susandhi prapt hui. और ये जो विषय है साइंस एंड परफॉर्मिंग आर्ट्स, तो मैं तो एक संगीतकार की भूमिका में यहाँ पर बैठा हूँ. और मैं ये स्पष्ट करना चाहूँगा कि जिसे हम शास्त्र कहते हैं या शास्त्रीय संगीत कहते हैं, वहाँ पर शास्त्र का मतलब कोई पदार्थ विज्ञान से या फिजिक्स से नहीं है.
जी,
देयर इज नो साइंटिफिक म्यूजिक. शास्त्रीय संगीत का मतलब है कि एक थियरी है उसकी. शास्त्र का मतलब यहाँ पर थियरी से है. जैसे राग संगीत एक थियरी है, ताल हमारी ताल क्रिया एक थियरी है जिसमें हम विश्वास करते हैं. तो मैं समझता हूँ कि शुरू में ये भारतीय, उत्तर भारतीय शास्त्रीय संगीत जिसे कहा जाता है, उसका स्वभाव क्या है और उसमें इंडिविजुअल एक्सप्रेशन के लिए या नवनिर्माण के लिए क्या गुंजाइश है, क्या स्कोप है, इसके बारे में जो कुछ मैं जानता हूँ वो मैं स्पष्ट करना चाहूँगा. ये हमारा जो संगीत है ये बहुत प्राचीन है, मतलब वेद मंत्रों से इसका उगम मानते हैं. फिर प्रबंध गान, ध्रुपद गान और जो ख्याल जिसे कहते हैं, ख्याल जॉन्द्र, ये 100-150 साल से यहाँ पर प्रतिष्ठित है, सुप्रतिष्ठित है. तो उसके बारे में मैं बात करूंगा.
जी,
हमारे संगीत में इसकी अगर हम वर्ल्ड म्यूजिक्स का जिक्र करें, जैसे कि वेस्टर्न सिम्फनी म्यूजिक है या अफ्रीकन म्यूजिक है या फिर हमारा दक्षिणात्य संगीत है, तो इसका जो यूनिक फीचर है हमारे उत्तर भारतीय शास्त्रीय संगीत का, वो है इसकी ताल क्रिया.
ताल क्रिया जी.
इसका मैं एक उदाहरण देता हूं आपको. जैसे कि सुगम संगीत जिसे कहा जाता है या सिने संगीत, फिल्म म्यूजिक, इसमें जो ताल प्रमुखता से उपयोग में लाए जाते हैं वो है 6 मात्रे का दादरा और 8 मात्रे का कहरवा. ये तालों के नाम हैं. अभी 6 मात्राएं ने इसको वॉल्ट्स भी कहते हैं. ढिंग चक चक, ढिंग चक चक, 1 2 3 4 5 6, 1 2 3 4 5 6, 1 2 3, 1 2 3. ये एक टेम्पो है, ये एक लय है. जैसे मिसाल के तौर पर एक सिने संगीत का मैं उदाहरण देता हूं. ये बहुत एक पुराना गाना है, मेरी उम्र 10-12 साल की होगी. आधा है चंद्रमा रात आधी, आधा है चंद्रमा रात आधी, रहत जाए तेरी मेरी बात आधी, मुलाकात आधी, आधा है चंद्रमा. अब ये डिंदा डिंदा तिंदा डिंदा 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 तिंदा डिंदा धक तू न दिन धक तू न दिन धक तू न दिन। अब बोल कुछ भी कहिए पर मात्रा बज रही है 1 2 3 4 5 6 1 2 3 4 5 6। अब ये गाने का आनंद हम अवश्य उठा लेते हैं क्योंकि इस गाने का जो निर्माण हुआ वो जो फिल्म चल रही है उसमें ऐसे समझा जाता था हिंदी फिल्म में कि कहानी में जब गीत आता है तो इट्स लाइक एन ऑर्नामेंट, इट्स लाइक एन आभूषण, उससे वो फिल्म के कहानी के सुंदरता में वृद्धि होती है। तो ये किसी ने बहुत सुंदर लिखा है, आधा है चंद्रमा रात आधी, रहने जाए तेरी मेरी बात आधी। फिर इसको किसी ने बहुत ही अच्छा कंपोज किया है, आशा जी भोसले ने इसको बहुत अच्छे से गाया है और स्क्रीन पर इसको किसी ने अच्छा अभिनीत भी किया होगा। पर आज भी मैं अगर 60 साल के बाद में 2020 में बैठकर कहूं, अगर या मुझे कोई कहे कि वाह वाह ये गाना कितना सुंदर है, हम रोज़ इसको सुनते हैं, तो आई थिंक देर इज़ सम मेंटल प्रॉब्लम, देर इज़ सम मेंटल ब्लॉक, क्योंकि इसमें आप इम्प्रोवाइज़ नहीं कर सकते हैं। सुगम संगीत का सबसे बढ़िया जितना उसका काव्य होता है, मधुर उसको कंपोज किया हुआ होता है, कितने सुरीले ढंग से गाया होता है, इट्स वेल रिकॉर्डेड, बट यू कांट इम्प्रोवाइज इट। इसलिए आपने देखा होगा ये ऐसे सुगम संगीत के जो होते हैं कार्यक्रम या शोज, उसमें जब वंस मोर दिया जाता है तो वो गायक पूरा शुरू से गाता है। व्हाई इट इज़ नॉट इम्प्रोवाइज, बिकॉज देर इज़ नो स्कोप फॉर इम्प्रोवाइजेशन बिकॉज ऑफ द शॉर्ट लेंथ ऑफ द ताला विच इज 6 बीट्स। तो इसमें अभी आज मैं गायक हूँ, मैं सोचता हूँ कि ये गाने में, और दिस सॉन्ग हैपन्स टू बी इन राग मालकंस, पर मैं यह सोचता हूँ कि मुझे इतना सारा मालकंस मालूम है पर मैं इसमें क्या कर सकता हूँ। मैं कोई एक रटने वाला तोता नहीं हूँ कि जिसको उतना ही गाना है, तो मैं इसमें क्या कर सकता हूँ। तो ऐसे जिसी समाज को जिस वक्त ये घुटन महसूस हुई होगी, उन्होंने शायद हमारे उत्तर भारतीय शास्त्रीय संगीत में दुगने मात्रों के ताल का निर्माण और आयोजन किया। जैसे हमारे यहाँ जो एक ताल कहा जाता है वो है 12 मात्रे का। अगर ये धाक तुन धिन धाक तुन धिन 1 2 3 4 5 6 ये अगर दादरा है तो हमारा एक ताल होगा धिन दिंदा त्रकतून कत्तिंदा त्रकधीन धिन दिंदा त्रकतून कत्तिंदा त्रकधीन धिन। अब ये दुगने मात्रा का 12 मात्रा का ताल हुआ
जी,
और केवल हमारे उत्तर भारतीय शास्त्रीय संगीत के ताल पद्धति में ताल का प्रथम हिस्सा और दूसरा हिस्सा, ऐसे दो हिस्सों में उसका बंटवारा होता है। ये दाक्षिणात्य कर्नाटिक म्यूजिक में नहीं होता, मतलब ये उन संगीतों का अवगुण नहीं है, हमारे संगीत की खासियत है। उन संगीतों के अन्य गुण बहुत श्रेष्ठ है हमारे संगीत से। मैं खाली इस संगीत की खासियत इसलिए बता रहा हूँ कि इससे नवनिर्माण कैसे संभव होता है, इसका मैं प्रत्यक्ष उदाहरण अभी देने जा रहा हूँ। तो जब धिन दिंदा त्रकतूना कत्तिंदा त्रकधीना, तो मुझे दुगनी स्पेस मिलती है ना? तो माय रिदमिक साइकिल इज लार्जर। उसके वजह से क्या करता है, क्या होता है इसमें कि गायक मुखड़ा लेके सम पर आता है। व्हाट इज सम? सम इज द फर्स्ट बीट ऑफ अ रिदमिक साइकिल। अब थोड़े हमारे जो कि पदार्थ विज्ञान नहीं है उस शास्त्र की थोड़ी बात करता हूं मैं कि ये जो पहली मात्रा है इट इंडिकेट्स टू थिंग्स, इट इंडिकेट्स द एंड ऑफ प्रीवियस रिदमिक साइकिल एंड इट ऑल्सो साइमल्टेनियसली इंडिकेट्स द बिगिनिंग ऑफ अफ्रेश द नेक्स्ट न्यू साइकिल,
द न्यू साइकिल
धिन धिंधा त्रिकतूना कत्तिंधा त्रिकधीना धिन त्रिकतूना कत्तिंधा त्रिकधीना धिन, मतलब नया आवर्तन शुरू हो गया। तो ये सब इससे क्या होता है कि हमारे संगीत में, उत्तर भारतीय शास्त्रीय संगीत में, हम लोग मुखड़ा लेके सम पर आते हैं। सुगम संगीत में क्या होता है, शुरू से ही होता है वो, जैसे आधा है चंद्रमा रात आधी, एक दो तीन एक दो तीन एक दो तीन एक दो तीन। अभी यहाँ पर इसी लय में अगर मैं दिन दिन धात्र तू ना कत्तिन धात्र कधीना दिन, समझोर से धन दिन धात्र तू ना कत्तिन धात्र कधीना धन, धन दिन धात्र आधा है चंद्रमा, आधा है चंद्रमा, आधा है चंद्रमा। मैं सम से शुरू नहीं हो रहा हूं, मैं कहीं से शुरू करके सम पर मेरी सम है, सम पर मेरा आघात है। There is a vehement stress which is known as sam, which is akin to sam.
मेरे ख्याल से एक arrival की feeling, आप कहीं आ चुके हो, पहुंचे हो, ये वाली आती है। और शायद इसके कारण ये एक तो arrival और उसका दोहराना, इसके कारण शायद cycle की feeling निर्माण होती है संगीत में, ऐसे कहे तो ठीक रहेगा।
Right, right. So you get a feel of arrival. Din din da trikatu na kat da trikadhi na इसको आमद कहते हैं, जैसे नृत्य में बिरजू महाराज जोर से दिन तथाई तथाई तथाई, कैसे आ गए वो,
क्या बात,
थई थई तथई थई तथई थई थई तथई,
क्या बात,
थई तथत तदई 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 तदई, ऐसे वो पदन्यास करते हैं। तो यहाँ पर ये अराइवल का फीलिंग होता है और इसमें इसी वजह से इसमें एक साइकिल का फीलिंग आता है
जी,
साइकिल का फीलिंग आता है। और हमारे अनसाइंटिफिक इंडियन माइंड को ये वर्तुलाकार भी लगता है। We find it circular. We believe it. It's circular because I think it is only in the circle that the point of beginning of the drawing of the line ends at the beginning.
बिल्कुल.
ऐसे हम लोग मानते हैं. जैसे धिन धिन धात्र कतू ना कत्तिन धात्र कधीना धिन. तो इसलिए हम लोग आधा है चंद्रमा, आधा है चंद्रमा। अभी देखिए मैं सम पर आया मुकड़ा लेके, फिर भी आवर्तन में जगह बचती है। आधा है चंद्र, आधा है चंद्र, ये जो मैं हाथ से बता रहा हूं इतनी स्पेस मुझे मिलती है मुकड़ा लेने कर सम पर आने के बाद भी। तो दिस इज वेयर यू कैन improvise, this is the space where you can create, this is the space where your individual feelings can prop in, can come in, because nowhere this is pre-composed or written like a western symphony. Aadha hai chandrama, aadha hai chandrama, aadha hai chandrama, as if I want to tell a story to a child or to children, so I won't have a very long complicated sentences like Walter Scott or Bhavabhuti. I'll have very small sentences, like if I'm telling a story, jaise usme chote chote vakya ho gaye, ek bar kya hua, ek tha raja, वो गया जंगल में, तो उसने देखा शेर, वो शेर रो रहा था, उसने पूछा क्यों रोते हो, तो उसने कहा कि मैं सम नहीं पकड़ पाता हूं। तो राजा ने उसको समझाया एक ताल, फिर समझाया कहां से शुरू होने का, तो फिर मुखड़ा पकड़ के शेर खुश हो गया और उसने राजा को खाना पोस्टपोन कर दिया। तो ऐसी कुछ स्टोरी हम बच्चों को बताते हैं। तो दिन दिन धात्र कतू ना आधा है चंद्रमा, आधा है चंद्रमा, आधा है चंद्रमा। दिस इज हाउ आई विल इम्प्रोवाइज इफ आई हैव टू टेल दिस स्टोरी ऑफ राग मालगांव संताल एकताल बिकॉज वर्ड्स यहाँ पर इम्पोर्टेंट नहीं है. दिस इज नॉट अ वर्ल्ड ओरिएंटेड म्यूजिक. ये कोई गजल या कविता नहीं है. यहाँ पे शब्दों का अर्थ आधा है. चंद्रमा एक गायक अगर 100 बार गाता है तो इसलिए नहीं गाता दोहराता है वो कि उसके सुनने वाले रिटार्डेड है. ही हैज फॉरगॉटन वेदर इट इज आधी रात है या आधा चंद्रमा है. उससे भूल गया. उसको दिखता है मालकाउस और उसकी रचना. इसीलिए जो स्पेस चाहिए एक जो बाउंड्री चाहिए लाइक अ बैडमिंटन कोर्ट को एक कोर्ट होता है उसका एक प्लेग्राउंड होता है. क्रिकेट का एक प्लेग्राउंड होता है. टेबल टेनिस का प्ले एक टेबल होता है. बिलियर्ड्स का टेबल होता है. ऐसे हमारा ये ताल है. जैसे चित्रकार का कैनवास होता है वैसे हमारा ये ताल है. धिन धिन धा त्रकतू ना कत्तिन धा त्रकती ना निन. अभी इसमें अगर छोटे छोटे वाक्य न कहते हुए मुझे बड़े वाक्य कहने हैं तो मैं इसका पेस स्लो करूंगा. धिन धिन धा त्रकतू ना कत्तिन धा त्रकती ना निन. आधा है चंद्रमा आधा है आधा है चंद्रमा गले का अलग लगा हुआ है. अभी मुझे लयकारी का आनंद लेना है. गमदानी द गम ग सम आधा है चंद धयानी धम धम गम आधा है चंद्रमा. मुझे और स्लो करना है. बड़ी भूमि बतानी है तो मैं इसका धिन धिन धागे त्रक तू ना कत तिन धागे तीर के चंद्रमा. अब इससे भी मैं विलंबित कर सकता हूँ. गायक करते हैं पर अभी इतना पूरा संगीत गाने का इस छोटे से अवधि में समय नहीं है. आई थिंक यू हैव गॉट द पॉइंट.
यहाँ पे एक सवाल. हाँ यहाँ एक सवाल मैं ये पूछूंगा.
हाँ.
कि आपने जैसे स्पोर्ट्स की खेल की जो उपमा दी कि एक बाउंड्री जरूरी होती है और उस बाउंड्री के अंदर खेल खेला जाता है और उस वो बाउंड्री है राग ताल के नियम. अगर आप बाउंड्री मानो तो उसके अंदर जो खेल खेला जाता है उसमें अगर क्रिकेट का उदाहरण ले तो उसमें भी एक बाउंड्री है एक नियम है लेकिन खेल नित नूतन होता है हमेशा नया होता है.
हाँ.
और उसमें जो खिलाड़ी होते हैं उसमें सचिन तेंदुलकर का एक अलग अंदाज है और राहुल द्रविड़ का एक बिल्कुल अलग अंदाज है.
हाँ.
तो ऐसा संगीत में होता है क्या?
क्या ये खेल क्या है? ये आवर्तन बांधने का खेल है. मतलब इट्स द स्पेस मैनेजमेंट. नो स्पेस मैनेजमेंट एंड इट्स विद ह्यूमन एक्सप्रेशन. तो जैसे वो आदमी का मिजाज होता है जैसे किसी का मिजाज जैसे एक समझो एक लोअर मिडिल क्लास का आदमी एंड हिज क्लर्क समवेयर इज एन अकाउंटेंट तो वो बहुत नापतोल करके मात्रा गाएगा. जैसे धिन धिन धा त्रक दू ना कत दिन धग दिन सम ग गम ग स सग ग स नि स नि धन चंद्रमा गम गम सग गम आधा है चंद्रमा. और एक कोई ऐसे जुगाड़ी आदमी है उसने पूरा अपना फॉर्चून वो सट्टा खेलता है. कभी वो लाखों में खेलता है तो कभी वो भीख मांगता है पर वो खुद को झोंक देता है. अभी आधा है चंद्रमा आधा है मा स्पेस का आनंद लेगा.
क्या बात.
तो ये जो हर एक का जो मिजाज होता है वो इसीलिए कहता है ये हमारे संगीत का एक श्रेष्ठत्व मैं मानता हूं कि जैसे चेस का गेम है वो 2-8 साल के बच्चे एक दूसरे से खेल सकते हैं, एंड 2 वर्ल्ड चैंपियंस ऑफ रेप्यूट कैन प्ले इट, ऐसे हर कोई एक बार ये ताल समझ ले और सुर समझ ले तो अपने औकात के मुताबिक नवनिर्माण कर सकता है. क्योंकि आधा है चंद्रमा, इसके बाद अब मैं क्या करूं, ये समस्या जैसे नवसिखे को होती है ऐसे 90 साल के रविशंकर जी को भी होती है. और ऐसे सीरीज ऑफ साइकल्स में द रागा इज इम्प्रोवाइज, और जो कलाकार की वो राग के बारे में जो संवेदना है वो उभर कर आती है लाइक एन एसे. यू नो देर आर क्लाइमेक्सेस, देर इज अ प्लेटो, देर इज अ क्रेसेंडो, देर इज अ पिटफॉल एज वेल, कभी कभी नहीं सोचता है, बट देन इट इज 100% ह्यूमन. Like when I am listening to a Beethoven symphony, I always get a feel that I am an outsider because it's a pre-composed music. It doesn't mean that our music is superior to Western symphony music, because no music can be compared, like no two cultures can be compared. They are not meant for comparisons.
लेकिन इस संगीत की जो खासियत आपने बताई कि इस राग ताल के पैरामीटर्स को पकड़ कर ये संगीत आगे बढ़ता है और उसमें गाना बनते जाता है स्पॉन्टेनियसली उसी समय. और आपने कहा कि जो कलाकार गाना प्रस्तुत कर रहा है उसका जो मिजाज है, उसका जो सोशो कल्चरल टेम्परमेंट है और उसकी जो आवाज़ है, इन सारी चीज़ों का बहुत ही असर पड़ता होगा ना उनके गाने पर, क्योंकि वो उसी समय बनता है. तो इसके बारे में थोड़ा सा बताएं कि कौन से बड़े कलाकार हैं.
जी, मैं बताता हूँ. इसलिए ये एक वैरायटी वैचित्र्य इसलिए आया है कि यह संगीत भारत के 2/3 हिस्सों में गाया गया है. और जब ग्लोबलाइजेशन का जमाना नहीं था, जब हर किसी के हाथ में मोबाइल फोन नहीं था, तो हर जगह की प्रांतीय वैशिष्ट्य अपने आप में दूसरे प्रांतों के वैशिष्ट्यों से अलग हुआ करते थे. जैसे लखनऊ का मिजाज अलग था और महाराष्ट्र का के संगीतकारों का मिजाज अलग था. और महाराष्ट्र में भी कोकण प्रांत में जाएंगे तो मिजाज अलग था, पंजाब का मिजाज अलग था, है ना, क्योंकि ये एक सोशियो कल्चरल पैटर्न होता है सब जगह का. मतलब लखनऊ के उसमें एक इत्मीनान था, एक चैनदारी थी, तो लखनऊ से जितने हमारे गुणीजन भागे वो ग्वालियर या इंदौर में आकर के बस गए. अब यहाँ आमिर खान का मिजाज देखिए, अत्यंत विलंबित यानी धीमा ठेका है, इतनी उनको स्पेस चाहिए. अच्छा, अब तभी लोगों के पास भी इतनी फुर्सत होती थी. और कला कौन सी उच्चतम मानी जाती है कि विच इंडिकेट्स मोर देन सेड एक्चुअली. जैसे आप आराम से बैठे और आमिर का आप मन में सोचते हैं कि ऐसा करेंगे कि ऐसा करेंगे कि ऐसा करेंगे. आई मीन द सेंटेंसेस when there is too much in between, that is the greater literature. That is the better literature. इसलिए न्यूज़पेपर
लॉट दैट इज अनसेड
न्यूज़ न्यू हां न्यूज़पेपर को कोई लिटरेचर नहीं कहते कहते हैं इट्स अ रिपोर्टिंग तो हमारे गायक भी कैसे होते हैं जो रिपोर्ट करते हैं मालकों उसमें क्या क्या हो सकता है उनको खुद को कुछ ही नहीं लगता उसके बारे में इसके दो प्रमुख उदाहरण मैं दूंगा पिछली पीढ़ी के जैसे कि आज से मतलब मेरे बचपन की बात 50-60 साल पहले जब ग्लोबलाइजेशन नहीं था हर किसी के पास मोबाइल नहीं था तो जब हम भोपाल जाते थे मध्य प्रदेश में तो वहाँ पर एक चावल होता है काली मूछ उसका स्वाद लेते थे जैसे कोकण में एक अम्बे मोर राइस है या मालवा में वो मालवी गेहूँ मिलता था अब उसमें इतना क्रॉप नहीं निकलता है तो सब जगह वो पंजाबी गेहूँ की ही पैदाइश होती है आप हिमाचल प्रदेश से कन्याकुमारी तक जाइए किसी भी पंजाबी होटल में आप भिंडी ऑर्डर कीजिए या करेला ऑर्डर कीजिए वो एक ही ग्रेवी में डाल के आपको देते हैं तो प्रांतीय वैशिष्ट्य जा रहे हैं इसलिए आज से 50-60 साल पहले जब संपर्क माध्यम और ये मीन्स ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन नहीं थे तो आवाज़ें कितनी अलग अलग होती थी मतलब एक अब्दुल करीम खान साहब किराना घराने के संस्थापक उनकी आवाज़ और आगरा घराने के संस्थापक फैयाज का उनकी आवाज़ उसमें ज़मीन आसमान का फर्क है आज अगर आप सारे गांव पर देखते हैं तो जैसे एक ही टाइप का खाना होटलों में मिलता है उस तरह सारे 20-25 जितने स्पर्धक होते हैं वो एक दो आवाज़ों के ही नकल उतारने की कोशिश करते हैं तो ये हमारे एक जो खासियत थी मिसाल के तौर पर देखिए ये किराना किराना घराना है ये आवाज के लगाव देखिए का एक सिंगल पॉइंटेड ब्रश बना के वो स्वरों का चित्र निकालने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं पिन पॉइंट रिखब की आत्मा क्या होगी सरे नीरे धनीरे रे मदनीरे दर्द रे की अगर फ्रीक्वेंसी ये है तो क्या ग की ये ही फ्रीक्वेंसी होनी चाहिए ग रे रे ग ग नी रे ग ध ग ध के पॉइंट से गंधार कैसे दिखता है ध ग नी ग नी रे ग रे नी ध ग रे म म म ग सारे ग मेरे पिताजी की एक स्टोरी बताता हूँ ही वॉज अ सेक्रेटरी ऑफ अ म्यूजिक सर्कल इन बॉम्बे और अब्दुल करीम खान साहब का गाना था और ये सुरों का काम हो रहा था विलंबित लय में डेढ़ घंटा हो गया तो दे हैड गिवन अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट टू एन कैटरर उसने बोला आप ज़बरदस्ती इंटरवल करो एंड ही वॉज बिग पेड ऑलरेडी तो इंटरवल करना पड़ा तो कोई उठा नहीं लोग वो स्वर की मस्ती में लीन थे और सबकी आंखें जैसे कि अब कब आंसू टपक पड़ेंगे ऐसी सब सुनने वालों की भावस्थिति हो गई थी। इंटरवल के बाद में भी वो खास साहब तोड़ी ही गए और महफिल खत्म हो गई। इतना ये स्वर प्रधान, ये एक एसेटिक्स है, नथिंग इज, उनको ऐसा संगीत को वो ये समझे थे। इसके विपरीत था फैयाज खां। अभी देखिए फैयाज खां जो थे उनका अगर अब्दुल करीम का सिंगल पॉइंट स्ट्रोक था, ब्रश था, ब्रश तो इनका चौड़ा ब्रश था, लाइक हुसैन।
अच्छा,
हुसैन नेवर हैड डेलिकेट स्ट्रोक्स। अब देखो ये बिलास खानी में उनका एक नमूना देता हूँ, उनकी आवाज रे 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 अब्दुल करीम करीम साहब इसमें बहुत ही कि ये स्वर कितनी महान चीज है और उसको डर डर के मुझे क्या मेरे स्वर लगेंगे कि नहीं, ऐसी एक एक मतलब एक इन्वेडिंग क्वालिटी नहीं है उनके गाने में, शरण जाने की, स्वरों को शरण जाने की क्वालिटी है। और फैयाज खां साहब का स्वभाव ऐसे था कि देर वॉज अ सेलिब्रेशन, मतलब बलम मोरी छांडो कलैया या पिया गए परदेश, तो पिया गए परदेश तो ही सेलिब्रेटिंग।
क्या बात,
ये पिया गए परदेश, जैसे कि खुशी हो रही है, आओ खुशियां मनाते हैं। अब जैसे बलम मोरी छांडो कलैया ना दिन बलम मोरी छांडो आवाज में मेलोड्रामा जो अब्दुल करीम की आवाज में नहीं था,
नहीं था।
आवाज का छोटापन एंड मेलोड्रामा इज अ फॉर्म लाइक अ कॉमेडी और ट्रेजेडी। अब हिंदी फिल्म्स में मेलोड्रामा बहुत बुरी तरीके से पेश किया जाता है, बट देयर कैन बी एग्जांपल्स ऑफ गुड मेलोड्रामा आल्सो। बल मतलब विरोधी भावनाओं का उदात्तीकरण, ये मेलोड्रामा की व्याख्या है। और ऐसे जीवन में होता है, कभी खुशी के पल होते हैं तो कभी दुख के पल होते हैं, वो जब दोनों तीव्र होते हैं तो उसको मेलोड्रामा कहते हैं, और जिसका अगर संतुलित है उसको स्थित प्रज्ञ कहते हैं। बल मोरी छांड कलैया अरे हाँ कर कन लागे रे नारायण चुरिया बलम मोरे जान बलम मोरे जान हो गल अगर कन लागे चुरिया बलम मोरे जान बलम मोरे जान बलम मोरे जान गल अगर कन
क्या बात
है,
वाह वाह वाह।
तो ऐसे लगता है कि अलग व्यक्तिमत्व, एक अलग कल्चर को हम लोग मिले। अब ये दो ही उदाहरण मेरे ख्याल से।
हाँ, एक सवाल मैं ये पूछूंगा कि आपने जो अब्दुल करीम खान साहब और फैयाज खान साहब के आवाज के लगाव के बारे में बताया, तो वो जो इतना सुर में विलीन होकर श्रुतियों का काम करने के लिए अब्दुल करीम खान साहब ने एक आवाज़ बनाई और उसका एक वातावरण निर्माण होता है, और फैयाज खान साहब का आपने बताया तो इतना अलग हो जाता है वो पूरा संगीत उन्होंने जो बताया।
उसमें एक सेलिब्रेशन है, उसमें एक कव्वाली नुमा
सेलिब्रेशन
खाली भरी कि में कव्वाली नुमा विरुक्ति है।
जी हाँ। जी, लेकिन उस आवाज़ की जो बात है, लेकिन एट द सेम टाइम आगरे घराने पर थोड़ा सा ये भी आरोप रहा कि सुर को छोड़ दिया उस घराने कुछ कुछ हद तक
सुर नहीं, सुर के नहीं, नहीं, क्या क्या हुआ
उसके बारे में कुछ बताएं।
हाँ उसके बारे में कहूँ ना,
इसके बारे में कुछ बताइए।
नहीं देखिए अब्दुल करीम के जो फॉलोअर्स थे, घराना कब बनता है, स्कूल कब बनता है, जब वो एस्थेटिक है वो सेकंड जनरेशन को और थर्ड जनरेशन को भी लगता है कि हम भी इसी ढंग से परस्यू करें, इसी में ही हमको सुंदरता प्राप्त होती है, क्योंकि वो खुद का सौंदर्य निर्णय नहीं ढूंढ रहे हैं, वो किसी दूसरे के सौंदर्य निर्णय में विश्वास रख रहे हैं, और सुर में रहना कोई असुंदर बात हो ही नहीं सकती है। पर अब्दुल करीम की जैसी आवाज़ थी, जैसे उन्होंने बनाई, क्योंकि शास्त्रीय संगीत या आवाज़ बनाने का काम होता है। अभी अगेन आई एम मेकिंग मे बी होपफुली नॉट एन अनसाइंटिफिक स्टेटमेंट कि बेसिकली ये जो एनाटॉमिकल, ये जो हमारा स्वर यंत्र है, लैरिंग्स है, ये 3 घंटे गाने के लिए नहीं बनाया है। उसका प्राथमिक पर्पज है कि हमारा अन्न फेफड़ों में न जाए। तीन घंटा गाने के लिए, या पहले तो 6-6 घंटे लोग गाते थे, उसमें तान भी लेंगे, गमक भी लेंगे, विलंबित भी करेंगे, 10 ढंग करेंगे, ध्रुपद भी गाएंगे, ख्याल भी गाएंगे, गजल भी गाएंगे, सब कुछ करेंगे, तो ये बनाई हुई आवाज होती है। अब जैसे आपका सौंदर्य और जिस कल्चर के आप शिकार हैं, ऐसे आपके विचार होते हैं और ऐसे आपकी वोकल कॉर्ड्स भी ऐसे काम करते हैं। वोकल कॉर्ड्स अनुकरणात्मक बहुत होते हैं। आपने देखा होगा घर में कई बार जो होम एड होते हैं वो उनके मालक, मालिक या मालकिन जैसे हेलो बोलते हैं टेलीफोन पर, तो ऐसे होता है ये, तो जो कानों पर पड़ते हैं आवाज पर होती नहीं आवाज वैसी। तो जिन जिन फैयाज खां के जो अनुगामी थे, जो उनके फॉलोअर्स थे, उन्होंने उनके जैसी आवाज बनाने की कोशिश की और वो बेसुरापन आ गया। तुमको अगर मेरा सौंदर्य मूल्य लेना है तो तुमको मेरे जैसी आवाज की जरूरत नहीं है। अरे जैसी तुम्हारी आवाज है उसको पिन पॉइंटेड बनाओ ना। अब्दुल करीम जैसी है नहीं पिन पॉइंट, ये रॉन्ग है।
करेक्ट।
जैसे मेरे जो गुरु थे कुमार गंधर्व, उनकी पिच और मेरी पिच स्वाभाविकतः, मतलब क्या बोलते हैं उसको, जेनेटिकली अलग थी।
नहीं तो मेरे ख्याल से फिर इसमें से ऐसी बात निकलती है कि जो अलग अलग आवाज के, जो अलग अलग आवाज के लगाव हैं, उसमें साइंस ने ये नहीं बताना चाहिए कि ये ही आवाज का लगाव सही है। रादर जो अलग अलग बड़े कलाकारों ने अलग अलग आवाजें बनाई, उनकी खूबसूरती अलग है, उसका अलग आनंद लिया जाए, और वो आवाज एक क्या थी।
हाँ, मतलब इसका यानी वॉइस कल्चर का इतना उपयोग हो सकता है कि आपको जो गाना है वो आप बिना कष्ट हुए गाएं।
हाँ,
पर आवाज में अगर आपकी आवाज बहुत अच्छी है पर उससे जो गले में जो काम है वो ही नहीं हो रहा है, तो फिर वो उपयोग क्या उस आवाज का।
आखिर में एक सवाल मैं ये पूछूंगा कि आपके गुरुजी पंडित कुमार गंधर्व, उनकी ख्याति थी उनके सुरीलेपन के बारे में कि इतनी सुरीली आवाज उन्होंने बनाई, और अपनी आवाज सुर में हो इसके लिए आपने उन्होंने आपको क्या सिखाया, कैसे आवाज का लगाव उन्होंने आपको सिखाया, इसके बारे में थोड़ा सा बताइए। उन्होंने आपको बताया हुआ आवाज के बारे में, आपने कई बार मुझे भी बताया है कि बंद आवाज लगाने को वो बताते थे, आवाज में धागे नहीं होने चाहिए, इन चीजों के बारे में थोड़ा,
मतलब उसमें जो ये आवाज उनको पसंद नहीं थी, उनको लगता था आवाज गोल होनी चाहिए, और
गोल होनी चाहिए
सब जो वावेल्स है वो विशिष्ट क्रम से
वावेल्स है।
ऐसे भी कहते थे नीचे देखो ऐसे था, और मेरी मेरी ओरिजिनल आवाज वैसे थी नहीं। पर बाद में मुझे ऐसे लगा कि वो जो उनके लिए ठीक था, उनके आवाज के लिए उन्होंने वो विचार बनाए थे, वो मुझे जो काम करना था, जैसे मुझको अभी एक देखो, जैसे वो कुमार जी गाते थे सजल नैना ना दिन दिन ना सजल नैना नैना ये जितना मुझे प्रिय था उतना मुझे सजल नैना सजल नैना ये भी मेरे गले से निकलना चाहिए ऐसे मुझे लगता था। या और 10 बातें बताता हूँ मैं। क्योंकि पुराने जमाने में एक टाइप का ही गाना कान पर पड़ता था, तो एक टाइप जैसा ही आवाज लगाए ऐसी धारणा होती थी। आज से 50 साल पहले कुमार जी के शिष्य को भी ऐसे लगता था, इसके लिए वो कई सारी बातें वो जो नहीं कर पाते हैं। इसलिए आइडियली वॉइस कल्चर का ये होना चाहिए कि आप जो गाना चाहते हैं वो आप एक 2 दिन के 4 दिन के, किसी को 8 दिन लगेंगे, किसी को 15 दिन लगेंगे, वो रियाज से आप गले से वो निकाल सकते हो,
निकाल पाए।
आवाज को एक आदत लगाना का मतलब वॉइस कल्चर नहीं है। या एक ही तरीके से आप अच्छा काम करते हो, 10 तरीके से करते आना चाहिए, क्योंकि 10 तरीके के आवाज के लगाव आज हमारे कानों पर आ पड़ते हैं यूट्यूब के जरिए। ये मेरा विचार है। ओके, धन्यवाद। आई होप आई हैव मेड सम सेंस, मे बी नॉट साइंटिफिक।
क्या बात
है। एंड आई डोंट थिंक आई वॉज टेरिफिक आइदर, बिकॉज दिस मीडियम इज नॉट मेंट फॉर सिंगिंग विद अबंडन। थैंक यू।
So many, many thanks to Satyashil ji for that lovely presentation. So now that we have some insight into how the Hindustani Khayal genre actually works, and Satyashil ji has also given us some wonderful demonstrations, some examples of the various voices as different as those of Fayaz Khan Sahab and Abdul Karim Khan Sahab and Amir Khan Sahab and Kumar Gandharva, and how all of these different voices have found expression within the Hindustani tradition. We're going to now turn to science and technology and see how it can really give us a wonderful tool, a wonderful magnifying glass with which to look at these voices and really understand them in a non-judgmental, unbiased way. I'm primarily going to be using this tool that you can see right now. This is a wonderful application called Voce Vista that allows you to analyze the singing voice. But before we get into the vocal analysis of these great musicians, I need to tell you a little bit about how the human voice works in a very, very brief manner. Many of you may be familiar with this already, but for those who are not, I'm just going to show you this image really quickly. So as you can see here, this is one way to think about how the human voice works. This is called the power source filter model. And very simply what that means is this is our source of acoustic power. Breath, the breath that we inhale into our lungs and expel through the vocal cords, which gives the vocal cords energy and causes them to vibrate. So this is our power source. And then this is our sound source. This, the larynx here contains our vocal cords. And these are the muscles that actually vibrate and produce the sound. And then this is the part of the vocal apparatus that we'll be dealing with extensively today. And this is the resonating filter, as it is called here. What that basically means is that this is a set of cavities, empty spaces within our heads, yeah, within which that sound, the sound that emanates from the vocal cords, changes and is shaped and sculpted into the wonderful voices that we've been listening to. So in order to get a clearer understanding of how the vocal apparatus actually works, I'm going to show you a quick video. This is from a Japanese researcher who has created some wonderful models of the human voice that allow you to very quickly and very clearly understand how these parts work together. So let's just take a quick look at that video.
This is the model of the human vocal tract with a flexible tongue. This is a whistle-type artificial larynx. First, I will produce sound with this artificial larynx by itself. Then, I will attach the artificial larynx to the vocal tract model. When I pull the tongue further down to make the jaw widely open, you will hear the vowel ah. Thus, we can produce several types of vowels by changing the tongue configuration in various ways.
Okay, so now that we have an idea of what the vocal apparatus looks like and how it works, the power source filter model, let's put those same sounds into this vocal analyzer and see what we get. So what you're looking at here is two sounds. This first one, this is your vocal, your laryngeal buzz. This is the basic original sound that you would hear at your larynx, at your vocal cords, if all these upper areas, your head, was taken away, so that there were no resonators for the sound to resonate inside. Just the pure sound of the vocal cords would sound like this. And like Professor Arai showed in the previous video, if you were to put a resonator, an empty cavity, such as your vocal tract, on top of the vocal cords, like we have in our bodies, and shape it in a particular way, you would get a vowel or a sound like this, which sounds like an ah. Okay. Now, let me quickly tell you, for those who are new to this, what all of this means. Okay. So what we're looking at here, basically, is what is called the harmonic series. This is common knowledge in acoustics. I won't go into it in detail here. You can look it up on the internet. But very quickly, for those who are new, whenever a body vibrates, so whether it is your vocal cords or a sitar string or a tabla membrane, if anything vibrates regularly, so let's say for purposes of argument that the vocal cords in this demonstration are vibrating 100 times per second. It's actually something like 132, but let's say 100 times per second. Then the same string, the same vocal cords are also vibrating at the same time at 200, 300, so that's 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, 500, 600, 700, 800, 900, and so on, times per second. Okay, how this happens is beyond the scope of this little presentation, so perhaps you could look it up, but this is a fact that any vibrating string or any vibrating body that vibrates regularly gives rise to a harmonic series, which is what this is called. Okay, and these bands that you can see here, these are all overtones or harmonics. Okay, which is basically the various frequencies that that sound source, which is the vocal cords in this case, the various frequencies that it is generating. Okay, and the incredible thing that this tool allows us to do is it allows us to isolate these frequencies. Yeah, so I've created this box, which is a filter. So I just want to listen to this bass frequency. Now I'm going to boost the volume because it's too soft for you to listen to. So perhaps you could hear it. Okay. So this is your basic 100 hertz frequency. And for those who are musicians listening to this, imagine if this is your sa, your sharaj, then this next frequency would be your tar sharaj, your upper sa. And then 200 hertz. And then 300 hertz would be your pancham, your pa. If you can't hear it, let me just turn it up. And then this would be the sa above that, the next harmonic. Yeah. And then above that you have your Gandhar. And then above that you would have Pancham again. and then you would have slightly flattened Komal Nishad, and then Sa again. That is your Sa again, and so on and so forth. Okay? So these are all the frequencies that are there inside this sound. And just to show you what that means, I'm just going to do a quick demonstration here. So I'm slowly from the top going to start adding frequencies so that you can hear how the sound is actually constructed. So these top frequencies are very high frequencies, they just sound like a buzz. But I'm gradually going to add frequencies below. So hopefully you can hear all the top frequencies, and notice how gradually this will start sounding more and more like that original sound. Now you have the full sound. So this is just to show you that this is how our vocal sounds are constructed. Now again, remember that this is your original laryngeal buzz, okay, without a resonator on top. But when you have a resonator, so you can imagine if you compare this with a tanpura, then your vocal cords are the tanpura strings, okay? Imagine what the strings would sound like if there was no tumba. Yeah, that's what this is. That's what this is. But if you add a tumba, a resonator to it, then depending upon the shape and size of the resonator, the volumes of each individual frequency change, as you can see here. So you can see here, for example, that this particular frequency is slightly brighter and dark here, which means that it is louder. But when the R vowel shape has been put on top of it, it becomes softer. Similarly, this one is quite dark, it has become softer. This one has stayed roughly the same. This one is roughly the same. This one here has become much darker. All of these have become darker, and so on and so forth. Yeah. And once that happens, because of the particular size and shape of your resonator, this sound, which is not any identifiable vowel so much in particular, becomes this sound, which is more clearly an akar. Okay. Now, why does this happen? Okay. How is it that the volumes of these frequencies change? Okay. Changes. So the reason that happens is because of the nature of an empty cavity. Now, I'll give you a quick example. You all must have sung in a bathroom at some point in time. I know I have. So every time you sing inside a bathroom, you must have noticed that because a bathroom is a small enclosed space that contains a certain volume of air, depending on the size and shape of that room. Now, every time you sing in a bathroom, you must have noticed that one particular frequency gets a boost. It suddenly appears louder. Why does that happen? That happens because that the air inside the bathroom, depending on the size and shape, wants to vibrate. It has a natural frequency, which means it wants to vibrate at that pitch. And if you sing that pitch, if you create that vibration in the air by singing at that pitch, the bathroom air loves it and starts vibrating even more intensely and gives power and energy to that particular frequency that you've created. Okay? Same thing happens in a bottle of water. If the bottle is half empty and you blow into it, the air in that bottle gives you a certain pitch. The air has a certain pitch depending on how long it is. And if you drink some of that water and make that air column longer, it'll give you a slightly lower pitch, and so on and so forth. The same thing is happening here in our vocal cords. So I'm creating a certain pitch using my vocal cords, but depending on the length of my vocal tract from my larynx to my lips, and depending on how my lips are, whether they're forward or widely spread, depending on whether my jaw is open or closed, depending on whether my tongue is forward or back or up and down, millions of possible combinations. Depending on all of this, energy boosts are created. Just like in the bathroom, except that your vocal tract creates a number of energy boosts, okay? So for example, we can see that in this case, I have a slight energy boost here. I have another energy boost here. I have another one here. I don't have an energy boost here. I have an energy boost in this area, and so on and so forth, okay? These energy boosts, the technical term for them is formants, but let's not get into technicalities. We'll just call them energy boosts. Okay, so the thing that is so unique about the human voice is that it is probably the only musical instrument in the world, the human voice, in which the resonator can change shape and size. like the tanpura has a resonator, a guitar has a resonator, a tabla has a body which is a resonator. These things, their shape and size is fixed. You can't change them. But even as I'm talking to you right now, if I turn to the side, you can see how the shape and size of this empty space inside my head is constantly changing. Yeah, and that is why the human voice is such a powerful and such a dynamic instrument, possible of such a great variety of sound, because the resonator can change size and shape, and when it changes size and shape, various energy boosts are created that can boost certain frequencies that the vocal cords create and diminish, de-emphasize certain other frequencies, such as is happening here. And this is how we create vowels. So as a quick demonstration, I'm just going to sing the five basic vowels for you, and let's see what they look like here. This is all very important to the actual analysis that we'll soon get into with the voices of these great musicians. E, A, A, O, U. Yeah? So you can see, for each of these vowels, E, A, A, O, U, I changed my lip position, my tongue position, my jaw position, the shape and size of my vocal tract. And because of that, you can see that you have an energy boost here and here for the E, but not here. Huh? For the U, you hardly have any energy at all in these areas, which is from about 1,500 hertz up to onwards. But you have lots of energy down here, and so on. For the akar, you have lots of energy in this middle area, not so much for the others, and so on and so forth. So it is basically these changing intensities of the harmonics in your sound that give rise to various vowels. And this is going to be important for our discussion. But the other thing that is important is that it's not just vowels that depend upon your energy boosts. Okay, it is also tone or timbre. Now, what is timbre? Imagine I'm singing and there is someone else, another musician, who's singing the exact same pitch. So he sings sa and I sing the same sa, the same note. You can still close your eyes and tell, if you know us, that this is my voice and this is his voice. How can you tell, even though the frequency we're singing is the same? It's because our vocal tone, our timbre, sound quality is different. Now, what is sound quality? Sound quality is the same thing as vowels. The sound quality is nothing but a different configuration of intensities, of volumes, of the various harmonics in our voices. Let me just demonstrate that very quickly. I'm going to sing the same vowel, an akar, in three very different voices. Yeah? And now you can see in my first akar, and my second akar, which is slightly nasal, you can see some harmonics have become de-emphasized here as well as over here. Whereas over here, the harmonic information is there in this range between 2000 hertz and 6000 hertz. It's all there, it's not gone, but it's not clear. It's hazy, it's noisy. That's because this is a breathy akar. Okay? So, and again, there are changes in the intensities of the various harmonics. So, the moral of the story so far, I'm afraid this has gotten a little technical, is that because of various configurations of your articulators and the resonant cavities in your head, various parts of the acoustic spectrum, of the harmonic spectrum, get boosted and some parts get diminished, and that is what changes tone. Okay. Now, it is based on this basic understanding of what voice quality or tone or timbre or tonal quality, which is the same thing really as vowels, but we'll talk about that a little later. Once we've basically understood what these things really mean, based on this information now, we're going to look at the voices of these two great masters of the Hindustani tradition, Ustad Abdul Karim Khan Sahib and Ustad Fayyaz Khan Sahib, to see what this science can tell us about their voices. So, what I've done here is I've taken two samples from actual recordings of Ustad Abdul Karim Khan Sahib and Ustad Fayyaz Khan Sahib. Here we have a few seconds of Ustad Abdul Karim Khan Sahib singing his famous Thumri Piya Bin Nahi Aavat Chain. And this is Fayyaz Khan Sahib singing his famous Jaunpuri recording, Fulwana Ki Gendana Mai Kamar. I've chosen sections in which both the artists are singing around their pancham, their fifth, which is around the middle of the range. So that should be representative of their overall voices. Let's just quickly listen. That was Abdul Karim Khan Sahib, and now you have Fayyaz Khan Sahib. Okay. One thing to note is that these two singers are singing in different pitches. Okay, so Abdul Karim Khan Sahab is singing in the key of F sharp, which is Kali Teen, that is his Sa, whereas Fayaz Khan Sahab is singing in C sharp, which is Kali Ek, which is a much lower pitch. And we'll talk about the implications of that later. But right away, based on everything we've seen so far, we can already see some major differences in the harmonic spectrum of these two singers. We have to remember again that these are old recordings, so they're not as clear as we'd like them to be. And also that this is not just the voice. This is the voice accompanied by instruments. But still, in both recordings, the voice is very prominent, and you can clearly make out which of the harmonics are the vocal harmonics and which ones are coming from the other instruments, such as the tanpura or the harmonium. Yeah? Okay. Now, you can see several differences straight away. Now, remember when Satyashilji was talking about Abdul Karim Khan Sahab's voice as opposed to Fayaz Khan Sahab's voice, he mentioned that Abdul Karim Khan Sahab's voice was like a pointed brushstroke, very pinpoint, very accurate, kyunki unhe sur ka kaam karna tha. Whereas Fayaz Khan Sahab's was a broad brushstroke. Yeah? Now, if you can actually, I mean, if you actually think about what a pointed and a broad brushstroke looks like, as you can see on your screens right now, you can imagine, let's come back to Voce Vista, and you can actually imagine this harmonic spectrum here. You can see it's so busy, especially up here in the upper regions. There's so many harmonics that are getting boosted in Fayaz Khan Sahab's voice in these upper regions. Whereas in Abdul Karim Khan Sahab's voice, there's hardly anything here at all. It's practically empty. Okay, you can also see that some harmonics in this area are very loud for Fayaz Khan, whereas they're very soft. Yeah, and in general, for Abdul Karim Khan Sahab, you can see there are only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 at the most, but not really, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 prominent harmonics. That's it. So pointed brush has a smaller number of hairs, bristles, right? That's why it's accurate. Whereas a broad brush has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, and so on. There's so many very prominent harmonics that you can see in Fayaz Khan Sahab's voice. You can literally imagine this as a painting that has been made by a broad brush, whereas this has been made by a pointed brush. Okay, so straight away, just by looking at these short samples of their voices in the vocal analyzer, you have an actual tangible visual that tells you what these statements mean. What does it mean that Fayaz Khan has a broad voice and Abdul Karim Khan Sahab has a pointed voice? So another important point is that, as I mentioned before, Fayaz Khan Sahab sings in Kali Ek, C sharp, which is a lower pitch than F sharp. In general, what that means is that lower pitches, right? This first harmonic, the first frequency, that the basic frequency he's singing, is called the fundamental frequency. Okay, so when you have a lower fundamental frequency, you obviously have more harmonics that are within the audible range, within the range of pitches that human beings can hear. Whereas if you have a higher pitch, a higher basic fundamental frequency, then many of your frequencies, many of your harmonics in your voice will go beyond the human hearing range. Okay, which means that people who sing in higher pitches, such as Abdul Karim Khan Sahab, male singers who sing in higher pitches, and most female singers, have to manage less harmonics in their voices. Okay, whereas people who sing in really low voices, such as Fayaz Khan Sahab, have to manage more. Okay, this is often why, and this is a big topic in itself, but I'll just quickly brush upon it. This is often why lower pitches, lower pitched instruments, are more difficult to keep in tune because there's so much harmonic information that you have to manage. This is also why higher pitches, such as female voices, tend to sound a little more precise, a little more tuneful, a little more clear than broad male voices. Okay. Okay. Now, the next important thing that we're going to look at is, as you can see, I've created these filter boxes like I had previously. I've created 1, 2, and 3 boxes, and I've divided this whole vocal spectrum into 3 regions. These are important regions, and I'll tell you why. There are actually 4 regions. There is a 4th region that should be up here above 4000 Hertz. But because these are old recordings, the microphones at the time were not as sensitive as the microphones we have today. We're talking about almost 100 years ago. These recordings are from the 1930s. So they haven't been able to capture this information. And I wish we had, because we could have learned something. But let's not talk about it today. But the information we do have is also very revealing. And let's talk about these three regions. So you can see this first region that I have here. Now I'm going to turn the other two regions off so we can just focus on this first region. This region, from about 2,500 hertz to 4,000 hertz, 2.5 kilohertz to 4 kilohertz, this region is the region that gives your voice excitement, what is called twang, yeah, a real presence, and also volume. Okay, so I'll give you a quick example. People often wonder about Western opera singers. How is it that there is a symphony, there is an orchestra of so many instruments, 50, 60, even 100 instruments, and there is one singer who is, without the help of a microphone, able to project his or her voice to the audience in the large hall without the use of amplification above the sound of so many instruments? Okay, so quickly, the reason for that is that most of those instruments, most of their harmonic energy is concentrated in this low area here. Whereas opera singers train their voices to amplify their frequencies in this area, to boost. They shape their vocal track to boost these frequencies from 2.5 to 4 kilohertz. The reason for that is the human ear, your ear, all right, is shaped such that these frequencies appear louder. It's the same principle applied in reverse, right? So because of the empty spaces, the cavities inside your human ear, these frequencies resonate inside your ear and therefore appear louder. So this already gives us a very important lesson for singers, that to achieve volume in your voice, you don't need to sing loudly, you don't need to exert force in your vocal cords. Instead, you need to train yourself, your singing apparatus, to produce these frequencies loudly. And anyone who's familiar with the music of these old ustads will tell you that Fayaz Khan had a louder voice than Abdul Karim Khan's. This is perceptual, and you can see why. Abdul Karim Khan Saab has hardly any information in this region, whereas Fayaz Khan has quite a lot. So let me just boost the volume of both so you can clearly hear the difference. And let's just listen to this excitement, twang, and volume area. Can't hear much for Abdul Karim Khan Saab. You can hear quite a lot more for Fayaz Khan Saab. So here we see our first major difference between these two voices. There's a lot to learn from this difference itself, which is basically that Fayaz Khan Saab's voice has more excitement, it has more twang, and it seems louder, primarily because of what his voice has in this region. Okay, let's move on now to the second region. Now this region, which is from about 800 hertz right up to about 2.3 kilohertz or so, this is called the vowel clarity region. This is what gives your voice clarity, makes it intelligible and communicative to the listeners in terms of they know what words you're saying. Now, Satishilji may have mentioned, or he often does if he didn't, I think, this time, that one thing Abdul Karim Khan Saab often did was he sang his consonants and his vowels such that they were round in shape. And so that very often, and this applies to many singers of the Kirana Gharana, this is a common accusation that is made on them, that it is not, their words are not clear. You're not able to understand the words that they're saying. Now Satishilji often says that this is because they wanted to blend their words into the Tanpura and into the Sur to such an extent that it becomes one. Because they wanted to them, tunefulness, surilapan, was of utmost importance. Alright? Whereas for the Agra Gharana, for Fayaz Khan Saab, words, the text is very important because Braj Bhasha was Abdul Karim Khan Saab's mother tongue. And for those who've heard musicians of the Agra Gharana, you know how much joy they find in playing with text and playing with words. Okay? Now I'm saying that this region represents clarity, vowel clarity. And you can see clearly, Fayaz Khan Saab has so much more information in this region, whereas Abdul Karim Khan Saab has very little information in this region. Yeah, so there's again a very clear understanding of why this is so. And just for demonstration, let's listen to just these two regions. So that's about vowel clarity. And now, let's just come back to this first region. Now, in terms of your overall vocal tone, the overall sound, the timbre of a musician's voice. If there is one region that really defines it, that would be this region. Yeah, this region is called the undervowel region. Let's not get into why. But in general, if you were to broadly describe two very different types of tone, of vocal tone, which is what these two musicians represent, which is why I've chosen them. One would be a deep, dark tone, and the other would be an open, bright tone. And that is largely decided by this area. Okay, so as you can see, the fundamental, the first harmonic, the basic pitch that is being sung by Abdul Karim Khan Sahab here is quite prominent. Whereas Fayaz Khan Sahab de-emphasizes it to quite an extent. His second and third harmonics are more prominent, which means that the main boost that Fayaz Khan Sahab's voice is getting from his vocal tract wants to boost these frequencies, not this first one. Whereas Abdul Karim Khan Sahab's vocal tract does want to boost the first frequency a little more than Fayaz Khan Sahab. And it is an accepted, well-researched fact in vocal acoustics that if your first basic harmonic is boosted, you get a deeper, darker tone. Whereas if it is your second, third, or fourth harmonic that gets boosted and not the first one so much, then you get a more open, a more brassy tone. So let's just listen to these two areas. So just to quickly recap, we learned about this first region that deals with the overall tone, the depth or the openness of your overall tone. Then we dealt with this second region, which deals with clarity and intelligibility. And we dealt with this third region, which deals with excitement and volume. Okay, so overall characteristic, clarity, volume and excitement. And now just keep these three things in mind, and also keep the individual sounds that you heard filtered out like this, and see if you can identify these sounds within the whole. So I'm just going to play the entire recordings now, and hopefully now we've developed a much more solid understanding of the voices of these two masters. Another very crucial aspect to analyzing the sound of a singer is the vowel quality that his sound has. Now, this concept might sound a little strange to people who are new to this and who are listening to this for the first time, but it's a fascinating phenomena in acoustics. To explain it very briefly, vowels, a, I, o, u, u, all of that, all of your vowels are nothing but pitches, literally. So if I'm going to be singing pitches up to about 400 hertz, irrespective of whether that is a voice or a tractor or a fan or anything, if I'm going to filter out and listen to only this area, it's going to sound a little bit like an ukar to me, an u vowel sound. Okay? So I'm just going to quickly try to demonstrate that. It takes a little training to be able to hear these vowel sounds, but perhaps you will be able to. See if this sounds like an u to you. In both voices. So as you can see, there is an ukar in both their voices. Similarly, this area between about 450 hertz to about 800 hertz, this should sound like an O to you. Distinct O quality. Remember that they are singing Pia Bina Nahi Aavat Chain and Nom Tom syllables here. They are not singing U or O specifically. But when I made you hear just this area, you could hear a consistent O, or in this area a consistent U. Similarly, this area here is an O. Let's listen. Just like that, this next area is an akar. The overall sense, the quality, is a. Yeah. this next area should sound to you like an eh, eh. Yeah? And the next area should sound to you like an A, A. Let's move to Fayaz Khan sir. A. Yeah, the whole sound, irrespective of what he's singing. As long as you're listening to just this area, it will sound like an A. And finally, everything above this area, I've only selected this much because that's all that's available to us. But everything above about 3000 hertz will sound like an E. This concept is the scientific term for it is absolute timbre. Yeah, vowels. So if you look up vowels and absolute timbre, you'll find information about this on the internet. What is relevant to us, however, for this discussion is that if various regions of the voice represent various vowels, then that means depending on which regions a singer amplifies and gives importance to in his sound, those are the vowels that are important to that singer. Now you'll notice when we saw Satyashil ji a minute before, or if you listen to many Kirana singers who sing sort of, who have Abdul Karim Khan Saab's idiom in their minds when singing, you'll find that they gravitate towards an aw. Pia. I'm exaggerating a little, but something like that. Rather than pia, pia is a more aw kind of sound. And you can see why. This region is the aw region here. Let me just turn off the others so you can see this for comparison. So as you can see, Abdul Karim Khan Saab is very prominent in this region. Fayaz Khan, not so much. A little less prominent. In the lower regions, this is the O region. Again, Abdul Karim Khan Saab is slightly more prominent than Fayaz Khan. Slightly louder. In the O region as well, Abdul Karim Khan Saab is slightly louder. Okay? But it is in the O region that he is much more prominent and Fayaz Khan is much softer. But in general, you could say that it is in the O and O regions that Abdul Karim Khan Saab, that these are the regions, these are the sounds that are important to Abdul Karim Khan Saab's tone, whereas then comparatively less important to Fayaz Khan Saab's tone. On the other hand, if you look at these regions, if you look at the R region, roughly the same, but Fayaz Khan Saab is boosting two harmonics here, Abdul Karim Khan Saab just one. If you look at the A region, major, major difference, right? Abdul Karim Khan Saab has almost nothing in this area, whereas Fayaz Khan Saab has very, very prominent harmonics here in this A region. And if you look at the A region, again, Abdul Karim Khan Saab has even less, Fayaz Khan Saab has a lot here. Again, in the E region, yeah, similar. But it is in the A region, where Fayaz Khan Saab is so prominent. And that's why if I were to characterize these musicians' sound in totality, I would say that Abdul Karim Khan Saab has an aw prominent sound, whereas Fayaz Khan Saab has an a prominent sound. And anyone who's heard these musicians, heard their recordings very often will concur, I'm sure, with this. Now, I'm just going to enable all of these filters. And just to bring together everything we've been talking about so far, okay, you will see that if your preferred sound is an oo or an o or an aw, a round sound, then what that basically means, if that is the sound you're giving predominance to and importance to, what that basically means is that you're filtering out, cutting out all the harmonics on top. And whereas on the other hand, if it is the A and A and A sounds, especially the A and E sounds that are important to you, that means you're bringing in with full force all of these harmonics on top. Okay? And this overall mix that you create is what is called your resonant strategy. Yeah? Which brings us to the very important idea of resonance and how science can really give us a nuanced understanding of this term. But we'll come to that a little later. Just one comment before we move to resonance, which is that in general, this is a very general broad observation and there can be debate about this, but in general, singers for whom tunefulness, being in tune, surilapan, is of prime importance, and I'm not talking about resonance here, I'm talking about tunefulness, those singers tend to emphasize their lower ranges, their lower harmonics, and they tend to gravitate towards an oo or an O or an aw sound. Whereas singers for him, tunefulness is not as important as presence. as excitement and character, if those are appropriate words, then they don't give as much importance to these regions, but more to the ah and eh and a regions. And of course, this was a very broad generalization. Vocal science allows you to get much more nuanced than this. But the more you start looking at details, the more interesting this becomes. Because instead of I'm comparing these two very different singers for demonstration purposes. But even if you look at just Fayaz Khan Saab, just one singer, you can see that when he's very conscious of his tunefulness, when he wants to become, or not Fayaz Khan Saab, anybody, any singer, in general, when singers want to become more tuneful, they will naturally gravitate towards an aw, towards a closed sound. Whereas when they feel their voice isn't carrying, when they want to have more presence and character with their voices, they will gravitate towards an air sound by emphasizing these harmonics. Obviously, all these great singers don't even probably know the term harmonics. They might not, right? They're not thinking actively in this sense. But intuitively, because their ears are so sophisticated and so developed, their sensitivity to sound is so developed, they do these things, they shape their vocal tracts intuitively, and that is what science allows us to understand. Okay. Now, this particular recording of Fayaz Khan Saab's Jaunpuri is an example of within Fayaz Khan's own music, is an example of a rounder sound. Let's just listen to it again. And if you were to compare it to this other recording of Fayaz Khan Saab singing Todi, let's just listen to it. So you can see even within the repertoire of one singer, the tonal repertoire of one singer, there is such variety. And you can see if you were to ask me to describe this sound, I would describe it as much richer, much more open, much sharper, much broader, much more brassy. And you can see why. Right? Your A and E and A region harmonics are so much more amplified in this version. And whereas your fundamental pitch, which is actually not this one, it is this. Can you see this blue line here? It's virtually non-existent. Remember I had mentioned how the amount of boost your fundamental, your first harmonic gets, decides whether your tone is closed and deep or bright and open. Where in this recording, Fayaz Khan Saab has virtually eliminated his under vowel, his fundamental. And that's why this voice sounds so much more open, so much more brassy as compared to his own voice in this other recording, right? So why is this so is an aesthetic choice that Fayaz Khan Saab is making intuitively and subconsciously in his singing. He wants, perhaps, I'm guessing now, which is an important part of research and educated guess, perhaps Fayaz Khan Saab sees Raag Todi as a more open and a more present rag, whereas he says Jaunpuri as a more closed and a more tuneful and a more somber rag. Or it could just be his mood on that particular day, which is the beauty of khyal music. It changes all the time. So just a couple of quick demonstrations to prove this point even further. You remember how Satyashil ji in his presentation mimicked the voices of Fayaz Khan Saab and Abdul Karim Khan Saab in order to show us the difference between them. So I have a recording of that, of his mimicry right here. Let's just listen to this. This is him mimicking the voice of Fayaz Khan Saab. Balamai more jhand kalaiya. And this is him mimicking the voice of Abdul Karim Khan Saab. Now, Satyashili's own voice is obviously neither like Fayaz Khan Saab's nor like Abdul Karim. It's his own voice. It's a different voice. But it's very revealing for us to see when one person tries to produce two different kinds of voices, what happens. So clearly, when he's mimicking Fayaz Khan Saab's voice, you can see that this region, the excitement and the twang region, as we called it, of his voice, becomes pronounced. Right? And when he tries to mimic Abdul Karim Khan Saab's voice, that region becomes suppressed. Right? So this is very revealing to see how one person can mold his voice, which musicians often do, and science just shows us that this possibility very much exists. And also when Satyashil ji was talking some time ago about Pandit Kumar Gandharv's ideas on voice training, let's just listen to that clip and run it through the analyzer.
ये आवाज़ उनको पसंद नहीं थी, उनको लगता था आवाज गोल होनी चाहिए और
So this is a good example of what I keep saying about how we can use science and the new research methodologies available to us to really thoroughly understand the information in the oral tradition. Now the oral tradition tells us, as Satishilji said, that Kumar Gandharv ji used to say that awaz gol honi chahiye. The voice should be round. Now, how can the voice be round? What does that mean? But based on everything we've seen so far, we can see that when Satyashilji produced the kind of voice Kumarji wanted him to, he basically cut out so much of the harmonic information in his voice, as you can see. This here is the goal or the band or the closed or this round voice. Huh? And what does that mean? What does round mean? So if you remember when we were talking about vowels, we saw that the lower area represents the oo, oo, and oo vowels. And you can see that has been retained. Whereas this upper area, this region that represents the a, e, a, a vowels, all of this information has been removed. But if you can see this area here, the area in around 3000 hertz, 3 kilohertz has been retained, because if you remember, that is the area that gives your voice carrying power and volume, right? And excitement. So I don't have time to analyze Kumarji's voice samples right now, but based on some cursory analysis, I can say that these are the qualities that his voice had. He had a rounded, deep, dark quality to his voice in the lower, because of this, the harmonics in the lower regions, as well as the strength and the carrying power of the higher regions. Now, all of this, everything we've been talking about so far, this technology and the science of the voice, the way it has progressed over the last decade or so, and the tools it has given us, all of this really makes it possible, as I've been saying, to investigate these ideas in great detail. And it also throws up new avenues for research that I believe are very important and should be pursued. For instance, I hypothesized some time ago that musicians, singers, vocalists who are more concerned with tunefulness tend to suppress the harmonic information in their voices. And we have a bunch of examples here. We saw Abdul Karim Khan Saab, we saw Satyashilji imitating Abdul Karim Khan Saab here as compared to Fayaz Khan Saab, and saw that he reduces harmonic information. We saw when Satyashilji talked about how Kumarji advocated, the kind of voice use Kumarji advocated, that again involved suppressing harmonic information. And this is a hypothesis that I myself have not tested. It's something that has occurred to me, and I'd be happy to debate and discuss this with someone. But my hypothesis is that the lesser harmonic content there is in one voice, the easier it is to manage those harmonics and keep them all in tune. Because another subject that I have not talked about that is important but beyond the scope of this presentation is that one can also now investigate the relationships between these individual harmonics, right? Satyashilji himself has often said that sometimes you come across a singer who is apparently singing on pitch, so you can't say he's singing out of tune, but the singer's voice still sounds out of tune in some strange way, although he's clearly singing on pitch. My hypothesis again is that probably has to do with the relationships between the harmonics. So that singer's fundamental is probably right on target, but because of the vocal tract shape and various things that affect the sound, as we have seen, the relationships between these pitches might not be tuneful, you know. Therefore, the pancham, which is the third harmonic, might not be in tune with the fundamental. The gandhar or the rishab or the dhevat might not be in tune with the fundamental. And that is what might give a listener the feeling of tunelessness or less tunefulness. Yeah, this is the kind of hypothesis that needs to be investigated. The other thing is the idea of resonance. Now, if you talk to any singer, irrespective of genre, Hindustani, Carnatic, pop, rock, whatever, everyone wants a resonant voice, right? The problem is that there is no one single definition of resonance in terms of vocal quality that is universal. What science shows us, in my opinion, is that there are different definitions of resonance. Resonance means different things for different people, right? So for example, resonance for Abdul Karim Khan Saab means this, and the resonance for Fayaz Khan Saab means this. People who admire and like and can relate to Abdul Karim Khan Saab's music mean this when they say resonance. And people who admire and like and can relate to Fayyaz Khan Saab's music mean this when they say resonance, right? And there is no question of saying that this is a better resonance than this or vice versa. That's not the point. When it comes to aesthetic choice, it's very difficult to have universal principles like this, right? What science instead allows you to do is to be descriptive instead of being prescriptive. So you can say that, is this the kind of resonance you're going for? Or is this the kind of resonance you're going for? And we can understand that resonance better. And if you want to emulate it, we have a much clearer picture in our minds about what to emulate and how we can go about emulating it. And this has serious implications for pedagogy, for the teaching of music, which I'll come to in a little bit. But I just want to touch upon a few more research areas that this technology throws up. So, for example, imagine how useful it might be to have data, to have information that tells us what the resonation strategies of the various gharanas or of various singers who belong to a gharana or don't belong to a gharana, whatever. What are the resonation strategies? There are various great musicians even today who teach their disciples. Of course, they teach them gaiki and bandishes, but they also teach them voice. And the one comment I would like to make, chote mu badi baat, forgive me, about the Indian tradition. One thing the Indian tradition could be said to be lacking in a little bit is that we traditionally do not have a separate pedagogy of the voice, especially in the classical musics, right? So if you cannot go to a teacher and ask him to teach you just voice use, which you would then apply to music, to whatever music you want to sing, right? So training your voice in the Indian tradition means learning the gaiki, the style of singing, the parameters of improvisation, the aesthetic choices of the gharana or of the guru. All of that comes together with the voice, and the two have not been separated. Whereas in my opinion, it might perhaps prove to be a healthier approach if students were allowed to learn voice use so that they're able to use their vocal apparatus efficiently without causing physical strain, and they're able to tap into the various resonation strategies and the various possibilities in their voices, which are of course connected to bringing out various emotions and various kinds of expression. And then if they're allowed, they're able to apply that independently to their singing, then that would be some sort of an ideal situation towards which we could aspire. Is this possible? Is this being done? These tools allow us to ask these questions and to try to find answers or try to find better questions. Another possible area of research would be, just off the top of my head, if you look at the music of Amir Khan Saab, Ustad Amir Khan, one will notice that very, very rarely does Ustad Amir Khan sing an open, full-throated akar on his higher notes, on his upper sa, for example. He tends to sing an ekar there more often. Why is this so? Is it because the way he is used to using his vocal apparatus, his vocal tract and his resonation, perhaps for an open akar, he's not able to get an energy boost in his higher ranges, which is something that science tells us, vocal science tells us, tends to happen as we go higher in our ranges. If you remember, I had mentioned to you that these upper areas favor the ekar. They sound like the ekar. It's easier to boost your ekar in the upper ranges than it is to boost an akar. You lose vowels as you ascend the range in the harmonic spectrum. Is that why Amir Khan Saab chose to use an ekar, or was there some other reason? Right? And because vocal acoustics are so tied into the physiology of singing, we are now in a position, in terms of what science knows now and what technology enables us to do now, to find real answers to these questions. I'd like to talk a little bit now for a few moments about the teaching applications, the pedagogical applications of this technology and of this science. It is a well-known fact, even Satyashilji himself said in his presentation that vocal cords anukaranatmak hote hain, which means the vocal cords are imitative. We sing or speak what we hear, right? We are built to reproduce. Our vocal cords function depending upon what our ears pick up. I can tell you from personal experience that ever since I got into this fascinating science, I have started hearing the harmonics in my own voice better. Right. So, of course, I continue to hear my voice, my own voice, when singing, when doing my riyas, as a complete product of all of the components that it has. But I can also, if I want to, pick out the individual components. Oh, I can hear the Gandhar in my voice, the Pancham in my voice, even the higher harmonics. I can hear the E quality or the R quality or the O quality in my voice. etc. I can even hear these qualities in the Tanpura. And what that has done for me, I'm just starting out, but I can tell you that what it has really done for me that I'm grateful for is that it has made me much more aware about the sound of my voice, the sound of the Tanpura, and the relationship between them. So for example, if I want a certain kind of tunefulness in my voice, if I can hear that, if my ears are that sensitive, my vocal cords will be able to produce it on their own, automatically. I don't at all mean to say that this is an easy process, all right? But I do want to say that these tools can provide very valuable assistance to us in making this happen. Theoretically, it might even become possible for me to bring myself, khud ko sur mein lana is something that is often said in the tradition. This is my understanding of what that means. Science can tell us what that means and give us a very important tool to help us achieve that. The world of sound has become more immersive for me ever since I've been doing this. I found that I'm able to tune my Tanpura a little better than I used to be able to because my awareness about upper harmonics has increased. And in general, this awareness leads to subtler and more informed listening. Not only in terms of the sound itself, but also in terms of why musicians do what they do. Right. So, of course, it goes without saying that very often musicians sing in a particular way because they want to make a certain structural statement. They want to make a ragavachak statement. But equally, it must also be said that musicians, as they sing for an hour or 2 hours or 3 hours or 4 hours, they are also dealing and engaging with their voice and with the sound that they hear. And often the musical decisions that a khayal singer makes as he improvises have as much to do with rag and taal and structure as they do with sur and with sound and with naad and with the sonic scape that they are engaging with, right? And I can arrive at a better understanding of why musicians do things in certain ways because of how their voices are functioning at that point in time. And if I can understand their sonic goals, their vocal goals better, that gives me insight into why they make their music the way they do. As a student of music, this has tremendous applications. So everyone who's ever learned music and tried to sing will identify with this. Even if you're born gifted with a beautiful voice, that voice doesn't work for you every day 24/7, right? Sometimes something clicks and sometimes you have a lovely, you know, you can feel your voice flowing and you can feel the resonance and you have a good sensation, you can hear good sound coming out of your body. Many other times you don't. You can't find that sound, right? What I can do now with the aid of this technology is that I can record myself. And if I have a recording of myself when I'm sounding good, when I'm doing things right, as opposed to that, if I have recordings of myself when I'm doing things wrong, which happens more often, honestly, for me at least, I can compare the two. And I can understand, the traditional way of teaching voice is, okay, lower your larynx, loosen your jaw, you know, do something with your tongue, do that with your soft palate, do this, do that, you know, don't tense, etc., etc., etc. And all of which is important, no doubt. But it's very hard to micromanage and control so many muscles. There are a million muscles literally that contribute towards your sound. But if I can get used to and really in a very subtle way understand what is happening in terms of sound when my voice is in better shape, then I can, if I can listen to that, if I can filter out those harmonics and listen to them repeatedly and really create an image of what my voice sounds like when it is working well in my own mind, then it becomes likely that at other times as well, I will emulate myself. I can become my own teacher. Again, I don't at all mean to suggest that technology can replace a good teacher, because a good teacher is a good teacher. There's no doubt about that. But teachers are not always available to you. And self-study is a huge part of learning and practicing the art and craft of music. And this, I believe, can be a very valuable aid in that process. It allows you to understand your own voice better. It even allows you to understand your guru's voice better. It can allow you to understand the voices of the singers you idolize and look up to in a much more nuanced fashion. And of course, one big takeaway for me personally from this is that this technology now allows us to move away from vague descriptions of voices, such as he has a harsh voice, she has a soft voice, there's a masculine voice, there's a feminine voice, there's a broad voice, there's a narrow voice. These are vague terms, and they can mean many different things to many different people. Right, but if you can listen to these sounds, these voices in terms of the harmonic content, you can form a very accurate picture of what those voices are. And also, while thinking about and talking about and making statements about and researching other people's music, it allows you to be descriptive rather than prescriptive. What I mean by this is we often tend to say that the voice should sound like this. This is the ideal voice. This is how a voice should sound. This is what resonance is. Instead of this, we can now begin to speak a more inclusive language by saying that this is one way of resonating. This is one kind of resonant voice. This is another kind of resonant voice, because beauty, as we know, comes in many shapes, sizes, and colors. And I hope that science allows us to deal with our own voices, to enjoy them and use them to their fullest potential, and also to celebrate the sheer diversity of voices that exists in the world and that a form like the Hindustani Khayal makes possible. Thank you.